The interesting thing about coming up is that it's very much about transition. A band reforming from the ashes of another band.
Our revenge on everyone who'd written us off. People who didn't think we were ever going to make a great record again.
I think we all felt very confident about it, but had everyone around us sort of not very confident about it.
There were other bands coming through in the Britpop era. But it was all for the taking for Suede. They could still come back with a really strong record.
Revenge and regret and all of those dark things are really, really key.
It's a complete rebirth.
Suede was Brett, Bernard, Matt and Simon, and then Bernard left, and then Richard joined. And then I joined.
A lot of people thought that Suede was Bernard with Brett singing on top of it. And I always knew that Suede was a lot more than that.
With coming up, the intention was not to make another Dogman star. So it was never going to be a sprawling opus. 10 songs, most of them 3 to 4 minute bangers.
Coming up as a joyous record, it was perfect pop.
I first heard about Suede when I was 10 years old. I was not aware of anything they'd ever made prior to coming up.
It was more successful than anything we'd ever done, and I don't think anyone was expecting that.
It's an anthology of anthems for the misfits, for the disenfranchised, and for the romantics.
Call it stylishly cult rock music. Basically, music that embraced things, issues, aspects of life that you were interested in, other than just music. I mean, I've always been drawn to music which was about a way of living.
These are early versions of what became Trash, because it was a totally different song at first. And this one here is the first demo I sent you of it, where you said, I like the chorus, but the verse isn't working.
Mm.
And then it was, I think previously to that, you'd said that you liked the verse, but the chorus wasn't working. I can't remember the order of events.
It became a completely different song.
It then. Did, yeah, from the first idea.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
It was called Piss Pot.
I think that was your idea.
Was it?
Nice start.
I kind of knew that Bernard was always going to leave the band. There was always that volatility there.
I mean, he'd given some clues in a Vox magazine article. Brett drives me insane, I think he said on the cover of Vox. And obviously, that, I don't think that was very good for band relations at all.
It's by public demand that an individual becomes the kind of figurehead of the brand. To some extent, it can suit other members of a group to not have that pressure. But then at other times, it raises issues of conflict, of envy, jealousy, or whatever.
I look at it now, and if it had been other bands, if Graham had left Blur or whatever, I'd have been going, well, they're fucked, aren't they?
Game over, that's it. You know, two groundbreaking, game-changing records, songwriting partnerships gone, they're done.
The band had been kind of discarded by the media, shoved onto a kind of pile of has-beens. And I remember tapping into that kind of bloody-mindedness of saying, well, we're going to show you, you know. And that gave the whole thing impetus.
It was actually on the front page. It said, Suede are looking for a new guitarist. So I just took a punt and sent them a tape and a letter. I didn't think I'd ever hear back from them, but I did, and they offered me an audition, and then they offered me the job, and it all happened really quickly.
Yeah, that's good. He came into the rehearsal room and played, and it just sounded great.
It's going out. Yeah, very well.
Looking back on it now, I think it was completely unlikely that they could have ever replaced Bernard so quickly with someone as talented as Richard. It was a complete fluke. It was a miracle.
The double punch of constantly being referred to by my age, even before my name, it was a 17-year-old, and also the kind of can they do it, can they carry on, when I knew damn well we could.
Looking back on that, that was a hugely risky thing for us to have done. Kind of risky, bordering on insane, to be honest.
Ginseng.
But
ginseng.
It just
that's
sort of felt
one.
Right.
Shoe repairers.
6 o'clock, shoot tomorrow morning. 6 o'clock call. The kickoff for Richard in the band was to tour a record that he hadn't written.
I'm so glad I didn't have to, on the day I joined Suede, have to write the new album, because that would, it wouldn't have worked.
During the Dogman Star Tour, he was growing into the role.
We toured for so long, so Richard was kind of eased into it.
It helped him build relationships, it brought his confidence out. It got him to understand what Brett wanted as a songwriting partner.
I feel good.
I'm so sorry.
I think the first thing that I wrote for what would end up being a coming-up track was Picnic by the Motorway.
Yeah, I think so.
We'd been touring Dogman Star for a couple of months, and I just thought I'd try and do some writing. There wasn't any kind of plan about let's write a new album, not at that point anyway.
See, that little chord change at the end, that's... That's Suede. That's what makes Suede sound like Suede, those little twists. I guess we were all a bit nervous with Richard because he was young. We knew he could play, but could he write songs? And yes, he certainly can.
Added note there from me. Thank you.
Such fun looking at the lovers in the letter with my little one. Hey, such a lovely day.
Picnic by the Motorway is stunning. They're describing lots of the landscapes I recognise on his album. Just very simple lyrics like these nowhere towns. To me and my friends from, you know, South Shields, we didn't feel that we had a lot of identity. It's an in-between place. That's where I find these affinities with Brett and what he's saying.
Because it was so early on in the writing, it was quite contextless. It wasn't... By the time we got around to writing things like Film Star and
yeah.
She,
yeah.
We knew what kind of thing we were after. A
yeah.
Specific sound, a specific album.
We were kind of trapped by the image that we had, and especially after Dogman Star, there's this kind of like brooding, Byronic image that we sat around all day smoking opium and velvet cravats, you know.
Hello.
By the time we started this record, it was going to be a lot more fun, you know. Don't disrespect to Bernard, but it just was. It was a lot less tense. We were all on the same page. And Brett was just a different person. He was just so happy.
Felt like a new band. It felt like starting out all over again. I think there was this thing behind us that we really wanted to show everyone, you know, we can still carry on as a band.
It was a strange mixture of self-doubt and a kind of insane, kind of almost like religious self-belief as well. We kind of did have this sort of thing of like, yeah, let's make an album full of singles and have loads of top 10 sort of hits, and kind of that self-belief sort of just manifested itself and we just kind of did it.
Most of the record was written round each other's houses, just playing on acoustic guitars, and it was almost like being like 16, 17 again.
I remember kind of waking up